I thought that wasn't so bad, you know, because it felt like just somebody bumping the side of my bed. It was very light. And so I started taking my arms down from covering my face, and I could see the window above me shattering in slow motion, creating a beautiful artistic design. But I knew it was going to pelt me with glass, so I covered my face again.
Welcome in. I'm Kimberly. I'm so glad you're here tonight. I have such an interesting guest, and I have questions for her when she's done sharing her incredible story. If you're enjoying this content, make sure you click that subscribe button and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our upcoming videos. And if you'd like to keep abreast of what's happening on the planet, but it seems a little overwhelming, I get it, you might want to sign up for our Friday morning email newsletter. The link is in the description box down below. Every Friday morning, we send out a very short, very sweet, informative email newsletter, including a lot of the important things that we see happening around the planet as we ascend to the new Earth. It's super easy to sign up. You just click the link down below. It's super easy, super free, super fun. I think you're going to love it. And now I'm so excited to talk to our guest today, Janet Tarantino. Janet, welcome in.
Thank you. Thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, I'm so excited to hear your story. It's very, very unique. Three-time near-death experiencer. I mean, that's one's a lot. Three is quite extraordinary. So why don't you kind of take us back to when this all started for you and tell us your story, and then I have a lot of questions for you as we wrap up.
Okay. Well, when I was 4 years old, I was listening to my mom's conversation on the phone with a friend of hers, and she was talking about adoption. And when she got off the phone, I asked her if I was adopted. You know, at pre-kindergarten age, you don't understand these kind of things. So, and I didn't quite feel that this was my real family. I felt like there was something more, that I had a different father, I guess you could say. I think I still have not disconnected from heaven at that point. But she answered my question with, "No, silly, you're our little girl." Well, I accepted that as the answer, but then I told her, "Okay, but I'm going to die young." But you know, at 4 years old, you have no concept of age. So I thought about what is age, and as I sat there, there was three images that went through my mind of different ages, and come to find out, those were the ages of my three near-death experiences. So I was actually seeing pages of my book of life and didn't realize that these things were going to come up in the future. So mine were planned prior to coming into this world. And then the first one was when I was 15 and I was very ill. We had went on a picnic with the larger family, aunts and uncles, cousins, et cetera. And I was transitioning from middle school to high school. And I was really excited about going to the orientation day that they had available at the school. So the new kids could come and get their classes and check their lockers and walk around the school and get acquainted with everything, and even meet their teachers if they wanted to. And I really wanted to go. But a few days after the picnic, I started getting very sick. Since it was a few days after the picnic, it wasn't food poisoning. But mom heard on the radio the week after that that there had been E. coli in some of the water at the park that we were at. I don't specifically remember playing in the water, but I did love water, so I don't know if that was the cause. But in any case, I got very ill, and mom had removed my sister, who shared the room with me, because I had two other brothers and they shared the other room. And she stayed in bed with me to take care of me, to make sure I was okay. Well, it was an extended length of time that I was sick, and I just felt like death warmed over as I laid there in bed. And while mom was next to me, I had a strange vibration in my ears, and I felt dizzy, even though I was laying down, and I felt like I fell. But that wasn't the case with my physical body because I was still lying in bed. But the next thing I remember is looking up at the ceiling, and everything turned to clouds because it was my spirit that had dropped out of my body, not my physical body that had fallen. It had went through the mattress and exited out of my body. And then it was looking, whatever you want to say, was looking up at the ceiling, and the ceiling light started to spin really fast and everything turned to clouds. And then I watched and I noticed that there were two spinning motions within the clouds, one on the left side of the room and one on the right side of the room. And the first one that opened up was a tunnel, and I could see through the tunnel a white room. And in the white room was a sumo wrestler. And I thought that was pretty strange, but, you know, I didn't think anything of it. And then I heard the other opening had appeared, and I heard beautiful heavenly music coming from that one. So my attention went to that that hole in the tunnel, I guess you could call it. And in came swishing a beautiful lady with a white dress and rows of lace on her dress. And she had long, almost black hair. And I was really interested in fashion at the time because I had worked detasseling corn with my brothers and cousin. We lived in Iowa at the time, and to raise money. And Mom had asked me what I wanted to, you know, use my money on. And I said, I want to buy some clothes for high school. And so we went shopping. But I was so interested in her dress, just by the being interested and wanting to see it closer, I zoomed up to it. And I was looking through the eyelets of the dress like they were huge caverns. And the threads on the edges of the eyelets were the size of bamboo shoots. That's how small I had gotten. And I thought of her as the music box lady, because that's the only thing I could associate with her, you know, of her with my time of life. And we didn't have internet back then. This was, you know, in 1969. So there was only like three channels on television. So there was not much to use your imagination on. So music box lady it was, but I also thought of her as daddy's little girl as well. I started zooming in and out of the eyelets of the dress, and I thought she was turning, but I think I was flying around the dress through the eyelets so I could see what it looked like. And I felt like a skier racing down a hill, and I could feel my hair blowing behind me as if I was speeding down that hill toward the finish line. And after I went around it, then I went back to I can only say above my body, because I was at the height of the window and the bed was 2 feet below that. And I continued to watch the sumo wrestler, and the music box lady had turned sideways and was communicating with the sumo wrestler. I didn't know what they were talking about because I wasn't included in the conversation at that point. And at one point, the music box lady moved up and away, and I thought of daddy's putting her up on a pedestal. So she left for a while, and then eventually she came back. I can't tell you how long she was gone, but she was gone for a while. And the sumo wrestler just kept watching me. Didn't say anything, just kept watching me. And when she returned, she talked to him again. And then they all of a sudden transformed into orbs of glowing light and flew past me or through me. It was just zip this way. And then they were in behind me on the inside of the room. And then they flew out through the wall and around to the side window, because I had two windows on my room, one on the front of the house and one on the side. They were in the side window. And even though they were orbs of light, I could see them turning and talking and then turning back to me. I don't know how I could, but I did. I noticed that they were communicating about me. And then the one light left, leaving the other light there, which must have been the sumo wrestler that always watched me. And then the other light returned, and they both flew off down the side of the house and disappeared. I knew they were friends of mine. I knew I had some kind of connection to them, but I didn't know what it was. And then eventually I had no choice but then to get back in my body. So that was my first one. That these things were so far apart. I didn't make any connection because that was at 15 and the next one was in my 30s somewhere. I'm not an age person, so I can't really tell you specific age. And that was when I was a mother of three. And I was divorced at the time. I had a good position at a corporate snack food company, and I was the network coordinator at the time. So my job was all analytical, you know, calculating miles per case and the best way to get the product there for the least amount of money. So I did a lot of analytics. And my parents had called because they lived 800 miles away. I lived in Denver at that time, and my folks lived in Boise, Idaho. So they didn't get a chance to see the kids very often because single mom, you don't have, you know, a lot of money to go on vacations and stuff for a lot of time either. So they asked if they could have the children for a month. And so they could spend some time with them. And they were planning on going to take them to Disneyland out in California. And I said, well, sure. You know, I was looking for low peace and quiet for a while. But it's funny, I delivered them out to my folks and stayed for a while. Then I came home and it was like the house was empty. And I just felt like it didn't feel right. You know, I looked at, you know, into their bedrooms and missed their, you know, their chattering voices and the flurry that they always caused. But I adjusted. And then over the weekend before I was to go back to work, I wanted to plant flowers on the large back deck that we had so that they could grow and be really nice when the kids came home because we liked barbecue out there. And this day I went out, met a friend for coffee and went to a flower nursery and made my selections of all the beautiful flowers and got potting soil and all the things that I needed, packed them in the car. And I started heading toward home, not realizing what was going to happen down the road. I hadn't gotten far, only like a couple blocks. I was at the end of the block where the nursery was, and I had to stop at the light. And then when that cycled to green, I had to go through, and then there was a big dip in the road. It was a big dip in the road. And then it came up on the other side. And no traffic was around at the time. I think there was one car going in the opposite direction, but there wasn't anything going in my direction, and the cars that were coming were far off in the distance. But while I was at the red light, those cars started to catch up. And when I was going down the hill, I noticed that there was a car stopped in the middle lane because there was three lanes in both directions. And there was no cross street, you know, nothing down at the bottom of the hill for a reason to for a car to stop there. So I you know, quickly surveyed the situation, and there was a park on the left side and a grassy area on the right. No houses on the right at all. And I could have gone on either side of that car because I realized it had stopped, but I didn't know if a child had, you know, cut through in front of him to get to the park or if they were going home or what direction they were going. So I stopped behind the car. Well, then the cars behind me started coming over the hill and they were coming fast. And I could see in my rearview mirror that all lanes were filled, and the vehicle behind me was a pickup truck, and the driver, I could see that the driver was looking to his right. I don't know if he was looking to his right to see if he could change lanes or if he was talking to somebody, but he was looking to the right. And I knew he wasn't going to have time to stop. In fear, sheer fear, I had realized that I hadn't buckled my seatbelt. I was going to do it on my way home, and I hadn't done it yet because I was still imagining, you know, planting the flowers. And I knew at this point I didn't have time to do it. And then all of a sudden I heard a voice say, lay down across the seat, cover your face. Well, I was the only one in the car. So I had no idea where this voice was coming from, but I did as I was told. And then the collision, the guy ran into the back of my vehicle. No, I didn't hear any screeching wheels, and it was like 45 miles per hour in that particular area. And of course, he was going downhill, so who knows, you know, if he'd picked up speed from that, but he annihilated the entire back of my car. Well, I just remember that I thought that wasn't so bad, you know, because it felt like just somebody bumping the side of my bed. It was very light. And so I started taking my arms down from covering my face, and I could see the window above me shattering in slow motion, creating a beautiful artistic design. But I knew it was going to pelt me with glass. So I covered my face again. But then by that time, my car had been pushed into the rear end of the car that had been stopped in front of me. And now I was going to be propelled forward. But instead of being propelled forward, I felt a huge arm come under my shoulders and another huge arm come under my knees. And I was picked up by something that I couldn't see. Maybe it was an angel, maybe it was the sumo wrestler, maybe it was God himself or Jesus himself, I don't know. But it was an angelic being of some kind. Because then I found myself above the scene, looking down on it, through a hole in the clouds, even though it was a beautiful blue cloudless day. So that hole I was looking through, I was now in another dimension, looking back into this one, and that cloud was the veil that separates it, and we can't see it in this world. I saw a vehicle pull over to the side of the road, heading in the opposite direction, and run across the street toward the car, and then all of a sudden, I was snapped back into my body. And I was laying on the front seat, across the seat, with my, like I was told, with my arms above, you know, covering my head. But after looking at the pictures of the remnants of my car, it was the rear window that I saw shatter. And the nurse, one of the people that had first came to the vehicle, had said, she's been tossed around the car, the seats are laid down. And they asked me if I was, and I said no, because I didn't know that I was, but I was, because it was the rear window that had shattered. But I had been, when the collision did go into the car in front of me, that's when my physical body, you know, hit the roof and ricocheted back down into the front seat, because my legs were now over the steering wheel instead of under the steering wheel. So I have no doubt that there was a lot of angelic beings, you know, manipulating my body that day so that I would be available to do what I'm supposed to do. So I have a, you know, it's very significant to me that there's a scripture that says, you know, that when you will call for me for help, and I will send the angels, and then you will honor me. So because that's what ended up happening. And that's one of the reasons that I have a YouTube channel too. And I wrote this book. I went through physical therapy for about a year from muscle trauma. Didn't have only but skin shins, but no broken bones or anything, but a lot of muscle trauma. And then the third near-death experience happened in my late 40s, I believe is what it was. And that's when I lived on a ranch. And I had developed an allergy that particular fall that I had never had before. And my sinuses were very congested when I came in after doing the chores, feeding the horses and making sure everybody was secured for the night, or at least letting them out in the morning. And we had cats, as most farms do, to control rodents. And they were also, you know, our pets. So I thought maybe it was cats that I was allergic to. And so when I went in at night, I would use decongestants to clear up my sinuses because it was so bad. One night it was worse than usual. And I had propped myself, propped three pillows on top of each other while I was in bed so I could lay on it, be at a 45 degree angle, and to help me breathe better. I fell asleep. I always fall asleep on my back with my hands over my tummy. And during the night, my chest started to hurt and I couldn't breathe. My breathing had been cut off from the congestion. And so I reached for my husband to try and wake him to help me. And I couldn't feel his body. And I also called for him, you know, said, "Gavin, please help me, please help me." And he didn't respond. Then just like that, zip, I was out of my body. I was looking down on it from above near the ceiling height. And I could see myself still in bed with my hands over my tummy and my husband laying next to me. So it was actually my spirit arm that had reached for him. And that's why I couldn't feel him. And it was my spirit voice that had called for him. And that's why he couldn't hear. So because we can't hear the spirits on the other side unless you have some kind of, you know, special technique as like a medium or something like that. But as I floated there, I felt like I had taken the biggest, freshest breath that I had ever had. And I felt free, absolutely free. And I felt like I was floating in absolute unconditional love, peace, and tranquility, you know, that you can't find here on earth. And as I floated there, I was in blackness, but that made the sense because I was, it was middle of the night. So I didn't think anything of that. And I floated and I was kind of up, felt like I was face up toward heaven. And I could see a silver cord float by in slow motion in zero gravity. It was just kind of going very slow across me, in front of me. And that silver cord is referred to as the tether in spirituality. And in the Bible, it's referred to the silver cord. You know, when the silver cord snaps and the chalice falls over, you will come home to heaven to me. And I didn't know that at the time. Didn't know that till much later. So somebody told me about it. But I also noticed as that drifted in front of me that I noticed that there was a pin of light coming through the darkness off to my right. And I wasn't concerned about it because I was, you know, enjoying myself. And I also noticed that there was something going on down at my physical body because I noticed a translucent, sparkly energy, the color of the sky on a beautiful day, was shimmering as it lifted out of my feet and then it lifted out of the ankles and then the shins and it worked its way up to my thighs. Well, the reason I could see that is because I was already my spirit body that had left the upper part of my body. And I was now watching my spirit leave the lower half of my body. And after I had obviously stretched to get out of there, that's why it happened that way, probably because it was a near-death experience and not my final time to go. But once that energy totally left the body, it drifted up to me. It was just pulled up and then I morphed into a different shape. I morphed from the blue spirit energy into the shape of an orb that glowed. Because I could feel, while I was floating there, I could feel my energetic arms floating out and they were up to my sides and they were elongated because they were no longer encapsulated. And then I could feel them pull in like this and cross my chest and I could feel my legs pull up. And that's how I created into an orb shape. And my vision looked like it went through a fishbowl effect while in the metamorphosis. And then I had crystal clear vision. Now, in the physical world, I couldn't see anything. I mean, I was a borderline blind. I had Coke bottles and I had to feel for my glasses in the morning. For work, I got contacts during the day, vanity, I guess you could say, but not in those glasses were so heavy on my nose. Every night I'd take them out. But I saw crystal clear, and I had no allergy. I was whole again and felt complete. And then I noticed that there was a light coming off toward the room from the left of where I was. In the meantime, this light that was coming from the right zipped into the room. And it grew up to me, grew up in front of me, and created a light being that I later find out is Jesus. But he had his arms open wide in a welcoming gesture, and I could feel the love exuded from him. And I felt the love that I had for him too, and he knew everything about me, no matter, and he loved me no matter my weaknesses or strengths. He loved me unconditionally. And I couldn't see what his face looked like. I could see his hair. It was a brown hair. And I could see that there was movement because there was a pieces of his hair that were gently blowing across his chin. But I couldn't feel the movement. I believe I was inside the tunnel and with him, and the light that was approaching from the left was the entrance to heaven. And that was God's light that was shining into the tunnel from the end. But when the light of God came closer, it was next to Jesus. And Jesus had on a white gown with sleeves that hung off his wrists, and was the robe was down to the ground and was tied at the waist with a rope. And I have pictures of these things were I have put in my book. And the light was alive, the one that was next to Jesus. It was God in all of his essence, and he was alive. Even though he looked like it was white light coming out of it, I could feel the colors. And Jesus put his hand out to me, palm up, in a gesture of come take my hand. And I thought of my daughter, Gina. So I still had the memories, even though I was out of my body, of who I was and my family, you know, the people in my life. My daughter, Gina, I wondered how she'd take my death. And even without asking, Jesus answered that. He said, she'll be okay. So I was ready to go. Who wouldn't want to go, you know, with feeling all this love, unconditional love all the time? But then God reached out his rainbow arms from the tunnel. He reached out his rainbow arms of energy, and he embraced me. And when he embraced me, it was like my back was against his chest and his arms were around the front of me. And then he showed me many movie moments of my life. Some of the moments I recognized because they had already happened, but some I didn't recognize because they had not happened. And as he showed me these, he communicated these moments matter, understand them. And I wanted to understand them in heaven. You know, I'll understand them up there. But they wanted to show me the immediate future of what would happen if I chose to go to heaven. And so the angels came for me. Then I changed from the orb into a white translucent form of a person. So this shows that our spirit can change forms as it needs to. And the angels gently touched me on the back of my elbows, above my elbows, and lifted me high into the sky. And I could see the lay of the land. I could see the houses in all directions, the ranches rather. I could see inside the ranch like there was no roof. And I could see my husband lying in bed. And I noticed that there was, I could hear a sound coming up the road, and a gravel road, because our place was a quarter of a mile off the roadway, and there was a grove of trees that blocked the dust from coming into the house so readily. And that was a vehicle. And I, even though that vehicle was just pins of lights long ways away, I felt like I was in that vehicle. I could feel the bumps of the road. I could see down the road as if I was the driver. I could see in the rearview mirror as if I was the driver. I could hear the crunch of the tires going over the rocks, just like my ear was right next to the tires. I had all perspectives because I had become one with the universe. I also saw that, that was actually going to be an ambulance that was coming to try and save me. But we lived in the country. There's not quick, response for emergency calls. And they were going to find that I was dead anyway. But this was a vision they were showing me of the future. But even though it was a vision, I was living it too. I was feeling everything. And I felt the ambulance hit the rut in the road that washes out when it rains quite frequently, because we have oil rigs that use that lane to get to their wells. And so that creates a problem. So they keep fixing it for us. Then eventually the fire engine comes too. And it was a small house that we added on to eventually, but there was emergency technicians in the kitchen and then two in the living room. One was my husband talking to another person. And then there was another emergency technician or two in the bedroom. But I knew they weren't going to be able to save me anyway. And I was okay with that. So I still wanted to go to heaven. And when I made the decision still to go to heaven, I was instantly back down in front of the light of God, just on the precipice of entering the light to get into heaven. And I was shown one more image. And that one more image was my middle child, Kurt. And just by seeing that image, I knew something was going to happen to him in the future. And if I wasn't there to help him, his life would go down a pathway that would be not so good for him. So naturally, we love our children and we want to help them out. So I told Jesus, I said, I'm not ready to go yet. And he nodded his head and smiled, even though I couldn't see his face, because he radiated light. He had light rays. He just exuded them. And he had light rays coming out of his heart center. And I was light too. So all these rays were interfering with me seeing his actual face. And I think that was meant to be at that point in time, because I find out later that it was Jesus. So then upon that decision, I transformed again into the blue energy. And this blue energy, by the way, I knew was my share of God's spirit, the Holy Spirit. And that is the way that this body works in life. It's an energetic being, and it is our spirit that gives the body, the force to move forward in life. And that's why when the body dies, the spirit goes home, to God who gave it. So I sat my spirit butt down in my physical butt, and I slipped a spirit leg into each one of my physical feet, but not all the way, because I grabbed my spirit knees and I rocked back and forth in my body until I got up enough momentum to lay back down and snap in and help her get up and gasp for air. But all the while I was re-entering my body, a voice from heaven kept echoing over and over again. And this message is not only for me, but it's for everybody. And that voice kept saying, love is the only thing that matters. Love is the only thing that matters. And that echoes in my soul every day. Everything that comes out of my mouth, I consider, is this the way I want to show my love? Because that's what we're here to do, is to, lift, love, and support people. So that's what I do. But anyway, I did sit up and gasp for air. And then I had to live my life wondering what was going to happen to my son. And I have no idea when it was going to happen or what it was. So life went on. And my husband and I parted ways, because after a transformation like this, I could hear his thoughts. I knew what his thoughts were, because he didn't understand what I had went through. And so I had to keep quiet about it. And he was, wondering if I was crazy, but I wasn't. So we ended up parting ways. I moved along in life. And interestingly enough, the allergy went away after I left. So I believe that was heaven's way of pushing me. Well, it was an allergy-induced NDE. And what was incredible about that NDE is, because After the accident, I still had things going on. So I had my husband, Gavin, had a cousin that I'd never met the guy, never heard of him actually. And he was coming to Denver area with a great speaker, religious great speaker. And I had never heard of the man before, either one of them. I hadn't met his cousin and I didn't know who this preacher was. But I did read a little bit about him because he offered to give us tickets to this crusade. So I wanted to meet his cousin. So that's why we went. And I thought it'd be interesting to hear what this preacher had to say. Well, it was at the Pepsi Center, and which is a huge, huge facility. And it was filled, you know, to the top. And we had tickets that weren't far from the stage because of his cousin. And so as we sang the songs, it was some of the songs where he touched me, Jesus, you're all I need, breathe upon me, breath of God, those kind of things. And as I looked back on that time in reflection while understanding these moments, I realized that he had created my near-death experience to reflect that as the answer to the prayers that I had prayed at that event that night. Because you don't realize when you're praying to the words of the song. And so I was praying, you know, breathe upon me, breath of God, you're the savior of my soul, et cetera. And when I turned into the shape of an orb, I was resting in a wand made of love, like children blow bubbles from. And that was his way of saying that he had, you know, he had created me with his breath, breathe upon me, breath of God. I finally put all that together. And these moments that I was shown have created a beautiful story about life and what we're here to do. Because he showed me that what understanding these moments revealed that we have soul contracts, you know, like my the music box lady was my daughter, Kurt. I had a contract to be with him, you know, to help him along in life during his difficult time. And I was there for that. And it's amazing what I said to him when his difficult time came, because he had gotten himself into trouble and had to go to classes. And I noticed he wasn't going to his classes. And I said, why aren't you going to your classes? And he said, I just don't see any light at the end of the tunnel because, And here I was before the light of the tunnel when they showed me that picture. So that was their subtle connection, that was what I was there for. And I said, you won't see any light, not meaning you won't get to heaven, but you won't see any light at the end of the tunnel till you start doing what you're supposed to be doing. And then you'll get there. Well, I saw a light go on over his head and he got it. And from that moment on, he did everything that he was supposed to do. And now he's a supervisor with a wonderful family, and he worked his way through it. So everything is overcomable if we take the steps to move forward in life. And these are all lessons that we are supposed to achieve, overcome and then check off those lessons as learned. But you also have to implement the learning like he did to get through these hard times. Because if you don't, it will keep cycling back over and over again until you actually get the message that don't do this, you know? So,
After your last NDE, such a profound experience. So profound to spend time with God, to spend time with Jesus. How do you integrate that into, physical life here on earth is so different than that world of love. How did you work on bringing that into your daily life and making it a part of you?
It's not an easy process. People that have near-death experiences, it basically kind of destroys your life until you can put the pieces back together again. You know, I knew that the blue energy was my share of the Holy Spirit, but I didn't know what the rest of it meant. I didn't know what it was. And as God does, he guides us along in life. You know, he said, I will guide you along the best pathway. He doesn't say there's only one pathway. And he uses other people to influence us. So my daughter was in college, and she had called me. She said, I keep having this bad dream, reoccurring dream, and I need to find out what it's about so it can go away. Will you help me? Well, of course, you're going to help your child. I knew nothing about dreams. So I said, come on up, we'll go to the bookstore. Well, we both love bookstores. I was especially interested in romance stories at that time in my life. And I looked and there was all kinds of dream books, but most of them were symbolic and I didn't understand that. And all of a sudden my eyes were drawn like a magnet, you know, metal to magnet. And it fell on a book that was called Book of Dreams. So I thought, okay, this is the one. And it was written by Sylvia Brown. So in the book, she talked about dreams and Gina had her answer. And so she changed whatever it was that she was doing and the dream went away. And at the back of the book was a segment for her next book. And that talked about the trip to heaven. And she talked about the living light of God and the sense of freedom and the silver cord, you know, all the stuff that I had experienced. So that was my first insight into that this was actually a near-death experience.
And that must have been you must have got goosebumps to read that.
Yes.
To read the experience that you had, it's so validating and probably just made you feel like, I'm not crazy. You know, this I had a peek into the other side.
Uh-huh. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And I started reading all of her books. And it came across the Angels book. And they just so happened to be having a class in Denver at the time about angels. And she wasn't teaching it, but she had people trained to teach it. So I asked my daughter if she wanted to go. And we went and they talked about the different kinds of angels. I know there's Raphael, who's the angel of healing. And he stepped in to help me during another situation where I had a growth in my mouth and they had to remove it and it grew back. And so I prayed for his healing. As I went under, I could see all green. Everything was green. I told the doctor that everything's green because emerald green is the color of Raphael's colors that I had at that time. And so I knew he was there to help me. And after I left, I didn't feel any pain. I didn't need any pain pills or anything. It was not like the first time where I couldn't eat anything. And I used mashed potatoes, you know, just to get by. Yeah, till it healed. So the angels are there to help us, you know, if we call upon them. And then eventually I'd started checking out little bit more about telepathy. So I went to check out some mediums. Actually, I started talking about what is that? Hay House radio.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I call ground zero.
Yeah. I call in when they're trying to get in line, you know. So I did sign up for some medium readings to see if that's how they communicated. And obviously they did, because the ones that I went to kept telling me, you know, I see you writing. And the next one would say, I see you writing. And I said, okay, I am journaling, you know, so I figured out I did journal. And come to find out, I was going to be writing, you know, my book. So they were letting me know that this is what I was supposed to be doing.
Yeah.
And yeah, then in the meantime, a family member had went to see, her mother had went to see a boyfriend of hers, and the boyfriend had a brother that was there to visit, and he was a medium, and the medium did a reading on my family member, and it was very accurate. So I said, I need his number so I can call him, and so I did, and that was James Demos. I called him and he said, yeah, I'll do a reading for you. But I didn't know that he specialized in connecting you with your guide.
Oh.
Yeah. So when I went to the reading, he brought through my brother who had died of a massive heart attack. And he was with our dog and that mom and dad had. And so I knew they were okay. And then he said that there's a cowboy here that says, I always liked you. And I said, oh, okay, that must be Dan. And I got to thinking, he's alive. But the reading went on and he says, I've got your guide here. And he is a sumo wrestler. I said, oh my gosh, I saw him when I was young.
Yes.
So the sumo wrestler was my guide and all the puzzle pieces started to fall together. And
which is why he was watching you so intently. Uh-huh. Maybe that was the message for you. I'm watching and over you.
He's watching all along. So,
He's
guiding me along.
So you wrote your book, Dying to See. Do you, you know, I always wonder why some people have near-death experiences and some people don't. You've had three. I mean, I think that's kind of maxing out the number. Do you feel like, first of all, do you feel like you slotted those in your life plan, or do you feel like they were added in to kind of coax you into this direction of doing the work that you're doing now?
I think they knew I was a hard sell. So because I did find myself in front of a panel of high spiritual beings after that, because once you have a near-death experience, you're likely to have another one or more spiritual experiences. The IANS organization, that's one of the side effects of near-death experiences. And that's one that I have. So I have continued communication when they want me to know something. And so one night I was pulled up to the in-between, in my spirit was, and I found myself in front of a panel of high spiritual beings. And they wanted to know what I learned about judgment. Of course, they knew I learned about judgment because they had made it known that they had brought Bob into my life for a special lesson plan for both of us. And he's my husband now, and he lives in Austria. So they had to do a lot of coordination in order for us to meet.
And I guess they did. Seems like you're in Colorado. That's
Yeah. And so, and I had the option of whether or not it would even let him into my life. And okay. So if I had not done that, I probably would have had to learn that lesson a different way, which wouldn't have been so pleasant, because there are certain lessons that are planned. And the panel of beings is the ones that plan how you're going to learn, how this stuff is going to manifest. I don't remember being included in on my choices of what I wanted to learn. But I probably did, and that's probably why I thought of Gina as daddy's little girl. But I didn't make that connection until later. And so I obviously knew something about what was planned and who was going to be in my life. And
you had mentioned, I'm just going to ask you this question really quick, that after your last near-death experience, you were able to read your husband's thoughts. Is that something that's continued on? Do you feel like you're more clairvoyant or telepathic?
No, not so much more. I can be. Yes, I'm actually a certified medium, but I don't practice it because that's not my comfort zone. My comfort zone is the writing and helping people in this world. I'm currently working on my next book, which is going to be stories of other regular people that have had unusual and interesting and hopeful stories that will help people. Mm-hmm. So, and it'll be done this year. So
yeah,
that's my comfort zone. And that's easy for me to talk about. I was very accurate as a medium, but I always worried about, you know, am I going to say something that's going to change something in their life? So I didn't want to be put in that predicament.
Yeah.
I suppose maybe if I practiced longer on it, I would have been more confident, but just wasn't my comfort zone.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like you found a path that really feels good to you, that feels natural and comfortable.
Mm-hmm. It does. Yeah. So I did these kind of talks because I didn't know there's more things that happened that are in the book and that kept showing me that this was important, because I kept seeing things that kept leading me back to this third near-death experience. I said, I know you want me to do something. Just tell me what you want me to do. And so I went to bed that night and I said, Dear Lord in heaven, please tell me what to do. And if you don't tell me what to do tonight, then I'll know it's just for me. So I wouldn't, then I wouldn't have to do anything. I wouldn't have to get out of my comfort zone.
And is that when the pin dropped out of the air?
Yeah. The next morning I woke up and I heard a voice say, make it about me. And he showed me visions of me writing a book and talking about it. So, so then I knew I had the answer that I didn't want. And then I had to find a way to write a book, which I'd never done before, nor did I think it was possible for me. So he was showing me that I had set up my own limitations, like most of us do in life, and we can do much more than we think we can, especially since we have his spirit inside of us. Because actually, think about this. When I was out of my body, I had my thoughts of who I was. I could see everything. And when I'm in my body, I look through these eyes. I'm talking to you, but it's my spirit talking to you. It's this physical body is just our clothing. So, you know, we're just, everybody is talking to spirit, even though they don't realize it.
Yeah.
And we're all,
when you look at writing a book, when you've never thought about writing a book and haven't written a book, that seems like a daunting task to me. I wouldn't even know where to start.
It was a long process, but I did get it done. And it's out. So,
yeah. Wonderful. Mm-hmm. This has been such a wonderful story and so hopeful and so filled with love. Thank you so much.
You bet. There's so much in the story that this relates to everybody. The story doesn't just relate to me because he works the same way in everybody's life. We just have to look at life a little bit differently and figure out, you know, what things keep cycling around and where we need to learn our lessons and move on. So
yeah. So how do we find out more about you?
You can go to my website, janettarantino.com. My book will be on there with different links to different bookstores. It's, you know, online with almost any bookstore. And I have a video of my dad's spirit leaving his body over there. I'm also on YouTube. They can look my name up on YouTube and find my YouTube channel where I share other people's experience. I interview them too. So just all the links, my social media links are on my janettarantino.com, and they can connect to me through there.
Wonderful. And we'll have all that information listed down below, the website, the YouTube channel, the books, everything. This has been so wonderful. You're just a lovely member of the human civilization right now. I appreciate your time.
This is my favorite subject because it's so helpful to everybody. It's giving them hope and comfort that life does go on, and it really does.
Yeah, and I agree with you. This is such an important topic because it does. It gives us a sense of purpose, a sense of peace, a sense of knowing that we go on, and it makes life, I think, a little bit more important.
Absolutely. Always remember, love is the only thing that matters. And that's what the message is from heaven.
Beautiful. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us. Bye-bye now.
Bye.
I hope you enjoyed this video. Coming up next, this is a good one. Or you might really like this one, too. Either one of them could be perfect for you. Before you leave, don't forget to subscribe.